Hi, everybody. This is Ken Corbin, and welcome once again to the Manufactured Home Show. This is where I have the opportunity to chat with the absolute best of the best in our industry, from retailers, communities, suppliers, and today with Ferd, the top real estate attorney in our industry for manufactured home communities. But as always, if you have any questions whatsoever, perhaps you know someone you might suggest to be on the program, or perhaps you'd like to be on the program, simply drop me an email to ken@callkencorbin.com. Now, if you'd like to see Ferd's interview again, or if you'd like to see all the interviews in the series, you can do a few things. You can go to my website, callkencorbin.com, and then simply go to the top right-hand corner, and you'll see the little tab that says Manufactured Home Show. You can also go to learnmh.com, look at the little tab that says videos, and all the program, including Ferd's, will be on that section. And now, of course, you can also go to my business Facebook page, Ken Corbin Speaker, and we're always loading all of these on YouTube. And with that, let me introduce today to you our very, very special guest, Ferd Niemann, who is a mobile home park owner, operator, and lawyer, as well as a real estate investor, financial analyst, entrepreneur, and attorney, whose career has focused on a myriad of areas of real estate. His experience includes mobile home park investments and turnarounds, retail development, redevelopment, residential investments, and real estate law. Before starting his own firm, the MHP Lawyer, Ferd practiced law at a top Kansas City firm focusing on economic development incentives, public finance, property tax assessments, redevelopment, land use, and zoning. Through his experience analyzing deals and sitting on tax increment financing commissions, he developed a critical eye for solving problems and navigating governmental processes. Ferd attended Rockhurst University to pursue his education and play college baseball. He enjoys chasing deals, playing sports with friends, reading great books, politics, involvement in his church, and spending time with his beautiful wife, Angela, son, Anthony, and their daughters, Margaret and Monica. And folks, with that, let me bring you Ferd Niemann. Ferd, we are so happy you've been able to join us. Thanks for coming on.
Thanks, Ken, and thanks for that introduction. I'm pretty sure that's the best introduction I've ever received. I'm not sure all that's true, but if it is, it was pretty good. So thank you.
Well, I think all of it is well deserved, and obviously your reputation precedes you. We had an opportunity to view each other just last week at the annual SECO conference, and you have been so helpful with many of our community owners and so forth across the United States. And with that, let me just ask this. Maybe you could share with us a little bit more specifically about your background and what brought you into the manufactured housing community space and that lifestyle altogether.
Sure. Yeah. Like you mentioned, I worked at as a financial analyst. I was a tax incentive analyst at Jackson County, where I was basically underwriting these complex commercial real estate projects with, big shopping centers, big entertainment districts, large multifamily projects, arenas, things like that. And I got to kind of get under the hood with some of the developers, and I was kind of paid to, throw rocks at the pro forma and try to give out as little government incentive as we could. And through that process, I started looking at, what I was making as a percentage return requirement on my single family and duplex investments relative to these big guys. And I was like, I'm making a higher percentage, but obviously that's, I could turn 100,000 into 200, easier than turn 100 million into 200 million perhaps. So I thought, okay, that's not a really good example. I can't really scale single family to the level that I want. So I thought, well, maybe I'll get into apartments and buy 60 unit apartments and 100 unit apartments. But the problem with that is it's pretty competitive, more sophisticated buyers. And then, price gets pushed higher and the economics didn't work as well as my single family. So I said, what else can I look at that's got a low expense ratio? And I came up with self-storage and mobile home parks through research and said, I need to get into MHP space. And then really started pursuing it about 2014. I did it part-time for a couple of years, but then I was And eventually I worked at a law firm there for several years, and I was still doing MHP on the side, and I was making more money flipping MHPs. I was doing flips more than buying a whole flipping MHPs, and I was practicing law. So I mean, I needed to focus on the MHP. That's what I've really been doing the last several years, is on the owner operator side. And then just in the last year, really been focused, really said, you know what, there's a lot of kind of compression in the cap rates, a lot of asset prices going up that I want to buy something at a 4 cap personally, but people are doing it. So I thought, man, I have all this background knowledge and experience in this field, and there's a lot of guys out there that are overpaying by a lot. Like, they could probably use somebody like me on their team. So I, you know, at least as a legal advisor. So I thought maybe I should transition more from owner to owner and lawyer. And I still spend 75% of my time on my own projects, but I spend now 25% of my time on legal work that I didn't do in the last several years, just because I kind of found a gap in the marketplace where I don't know of any other, so I'm either the best or the worst of both MHP owner/lawyer in the country, because I don't know of any other lawyers out there that are practicing this field as an operator. So I just thought, you know, let's try to use the knowledge I have from an operational standpoint and use it as counsel to help other people. And it's been working out really well.
Well, let me piggyback on that. You know, there's a lot of people that practice law, but your specialty is in the mobile home park community space. So
it is, yeah.
How does that differentiate you from these typical lawyers that, you know, a community owner will come up and say, you know, listen, I'm thinking about buying a park. You know, what do you suggest I do? So I'm sure there's some big differences.
Sure. Well, being just my background as a real estate lawyer, I did municipal law too. So I worked in county government for 5 years. I was the county appraiser. I had a 75-person team and an $8 million operating budget. It was running a department of government. So I had the government knowledge. I did land use, zoning, tax incentives. I've got finance, accounting, MBA degrees behind me. So I understand the kind of math, if you will, and the tax impacts. But then on the MHP stuff, that I think what separates me from other lawyers is the fact that I've done it in the trenches. Like, I know the different types of water and sewer systems. I know how to, I've signed notes. I've raised capital. I've got my retailer's license. You know, I've worked 21st years. I've bought from manufacturers direct. I know the HUD regulations. I've gone through the city code stuff. I understand grandfathering and fighting cities on that. So, and of course, I got the underlying legal knowledge of, like, I know how to do an operating agreement, a lease, and kind of your title work, your blocking and tackling of real estate. But I think what I can bring to the table, and this is why my clients seem to love it, is I can cut. They generally bring me in on a zoning issue, and then they're like, oh, you know how to do this, you know, do this, you know, this, and it ends up being, you know, more operational consulting than legal by the end of the deal. Is there, like, hey, look at my pro forma. What do you think about this? Can we reach this lease up? Do I have enough reserves? Things like that. So it's really just the experience that I have in the field, so to speak, as an MHP owner, that is different than the guy that can draft a lease or draft a contract. Like, any decent lawyer can draft a contract. And there, I'm sure there are lawyers out there that can draft bigger, better contracts than me. But is the contract overkill from MHP, but underkill for what you need for MHP, key provisions that are not in, like when I did retail, very different looking at a triple net lease. You know, you need tenant estoppels and things like that in a triple net lease situation in retail. That it's pretty, a lot of mobile home park sellers don't even have written leases. So you're not going to get tenant estoppels from tenants that are on a month to month verbal lease. So it's just a different level of underwriting for a different asset type.
Well, let me ask you this. There's a lot of people that have been in this industry for a long time that call you, but people that are just thinking about getting into this industry, getting into this business as an investor, new investors, how should they evaluate our industry as far as, is it something they should jump in with both feet?
Well, I think I'm very bullish on the industry that they should jump in. As far as with both feet, I think it depends on who you're jumping in with. There's a lot of promoters out there with big funds. I sold the park to this fund out of Pittsburgh, and one of the guys, he was an old, I think, JP Morgan or Wells Fargo banker, and he raised $50 million cash in like 30 days. So he had all this money, and he had to go chase deals. Like, I got to go, you got to, with $50 million equity, you got to chase 200 $1 million deals. That's pretty impractical to go chase 200 deals and close on them. So then they want to chase bigger deals. Well, the bigger deals are very competitive, and they're going to be going to the bigger REITs. So you're not going to buy those at an 8 cap very easily. You're going to buy them at 5 or 6. Well, this guy's got a system built on an 8 cap. He's got this incentive to put the money in the game, despite not being able to find enough deals to satisfy his yield requirements. So he's convinced people I've got this target metric, and I would never invest with them, but as a requirement of the sale of one of my parts, I had to leave a little bit of money in the deal so I get to see under the hood. I'm like, this guy is a joke, and he's out there overpaying for stuff to push deal flow, to get more fees, doesn't have any operational experience. I still own like 15 homes in one of the parts I sold him. So I see this park. I go there every once in a while and look at it. I see the deterioration of the park. I've seen tenant-owned homes move out two or three in the last 6 months, where tenant homes never move out, very rarely. So just if I want to jump in both feet, I may say, oh my gosh, there's a guy, he's got a fund, I can invest. Look at this great pro forma, I'm going to make all this money. It'd be the worst decision you ever made. So you really need to underwrite. I mean, people underwrite and then have scrutiny when you're hiring someone, when you're picking a spouse. Why would you not underwrite somebody on other things like investments in the new asset class? And in the mobile home park space, it's historically been so ma and pa, there's not a ton of professional operators out there, despite the guys that are professional fundraisers. So you really got to, that's what I would ask anybody that I put money into. I would say, how many deals have you done? Let me talk some referrals. Let me go look at one or two of those deals. Because, and I didn't do that on this guy because it was his first fund. And I thought I was selling for a big price. So I left like $60,000 in the deal. That $60,000 is frankly like a sunk cost at this point. And that sucks. But at least it wasn't my hard-earned money, $60,000 or some people. There's another person in this fund that has $2 million equity in the deal. And they're just sitting there like, I can't even get a K-1. I can't even get a monthly report, a quarterly report, annual report. So I say jump in, but don't jump in with both feet. Jump in with your toe in the water first, and then maybe put your toe in a couple different ponds before you jump in.
Well, that, again, piggies back to the next question I would have on that. So I'm a novice investor. And I'm looking at the manufactured home community space. Maybe would there be a few tips that you might recommend that novice investor in looking at it?
Yeah, I mean, most of the investors coming in are not going to get in other people's deals. Like if you're a rookie investor, you're probably not getting in my deal because there's a line of people, there's existing investors, but then also there's the accredited investor requirement. So your options to get in are either find a local guy, like a private placement memorandum, like somebody like me to get in. Those are tough to get in. Mm-hmm. The second option is to buy a publicly traded company like a REIT, like Sun Communities or something. Well, that's kind of like buying a stock. It's just a stock with a different underlying asset. So the third option is to do it yourself, do it yourself with a couple of partners and to really be the owner. So that's what most people are doing. There's a lot of people get in this space. I think what they need to do first is really identify their deal criteria and in general, like how big is the deal, what geographic region, what's their yield requirement. You probably don't want to go buy a $5 million 500 unit park, your first deal. You want to probably start smaller, but then you need to look at some of the more challenging things like, do you want a private sewer system? Do you want a private well system on your first park that's got more hair on it? Can you afford to take that risk? Do you want a park? My first park was like 70% occupied. So that was ideal for me. It wasn't 99% occupied where I'd have to pay a premium and I wouldn't really learn a lot, but it wasn't 20% occupied where I was potentially not going to get over the hump. So now I'm more comfortable buying 20% occupied parks. But I think if somebody looking at the space, you got to identify and I've got a whole podcast on this on my podcast on different deal criteria for initial evaluation and then deal. And then eventually, if you get into the minutiae, the underlying assumptions in your pro forma. Well, I think it's a joke, but there's been more fiction written in Microsoft Excel than in Microsoft Word. And I think that's true. As somebody that I'm very proficient in Excel, I could manipulate the heck out of the numbers and show this unbelievable end result. But the reality is, can I implement that business plan from a capital raise, from a debt raise, from a management and operational, and then are my underlying assumptions, property tax, mowing, snow plowing, lease up, are those sort of assumptions all accurate? And I get brought in, unfortunately, a lot of my legal assignments I get brought in at the 11th hour. And I can't fix them. I had a guy recently, he didn't get a phase one environmental. I said, you can't close on this property. He's like, well, I got to get my first deal. I'll think about that the next one. I'm like, you have to stop. And he didn't listen. And he closed it. So I did my share, little small scope work. And it was a very low cost assignment. But the most valuable advice I gave him was not listened to. So the next time I'll probably get a bigger scope of work, but it's too late. And if that deal goes wrong, there is no next time for either of us. So just doing your due diligence. There's lots of good resources out there now. I mean, there's lots of other pros and gurus in the industry besides myself that can, and there's conferences like the CECO conference where we were at last week that is full of information. So I think, man, before I would take a bite at that apple, I would sure do my homework. And it's pretty easy now compared to 10 years ago when there was only really one or two resources available.
Well, let me ask you this. You know, things are changing dramatically nowadays. From an operator's perspective, how are you recommending we stay ahead of the curve during this unfortunate pandemic crisis? What are you looking at, and what changes are you making as an operator?
Well, a lot of the changes I'm making are really stuff that's forced upon me. I mean, we're following the CDC guidelines, I guess, in the sense that we're not doing open houses. That's the change we do. We're not doing open houses. We're doing more one-on-one showings.
Right.
But that hasn't really been a big hurt for us because our inventory is moving so fast. Our biggest hurt has been the manufacturers can't produce the product fast enough because there's new demand in the industry and they can't get the materials. So they're also pushing the prices up. So now these mobile homes are going up $3,000 and $4,000 and $5,000 for a single wide. And some of them I've already pre-sold. I can't go back to that person and say, hey, by the way, I need another $5,000. They're going to think I'm a shady used car salesman. They're not going to believe, oh, it's because of the manufacturer. So then I got to choose, am I going to eat the cost? I can push the next house up, but every dollar you push up is another, 10% of that's another down payment dollar your tenants need. And then they got to get approved for the loan for that. So that pricing of the mobile homes has been a challenge. There's been some dip in collections because of the COVID impact. At first, COVID was really good for us because people had these stimulus checks and we sold more homes in April and May than we ever have.
Right.
Now, so we've got a few more people that are falling behind or they're behind on purpose. You're like, oh, I can't, COVID, I don't have to pay. Like, you drive a Pizza Hut car. I just saw you. Pizza Hut's booming right now. You're not out of work. You're making more tips than you ever did, but you're just relying on this excuse. So I think I get in my opinion elsewhere on the stimulus act and the good and the bad of how the money and the incentives were doled out. But overall, I think COVID's going to be good for our industry because it's shined a light on the stability and the kind of the hardiness that we have relative to other asset classes like retail, hospitality, industrial, and self-storage are kind of geographic based, in my opinion. And some self-storage and industrial is doing great, some is not. But by and large, and offices, I think, is going to hurt overall in this. But by and large, I think MHP is going to be better. So like, I feel like all of my parks, they're more valuable than they were 6 months ago, even though my NOI has gone down some on collections,
right.
It's gone up some just based on rent increases that are just
sure.
Annual small rent increases. But because of the cap rate compression, the actual asset values are at all-time highs, at least since I've been doing this six, seven years.
Yeah.
In my current timeline of career, they're at all-time highs.
Well, let me kind of go off topic just for a moment and talk a little bit about non-conforming and discriminatory zoning. As an attorney, And with your background and various governmental agencies, I'm sure you can share some insight into those two things.
Yeah, so I mean, there's really three types of zoning classification for a mobile home park, and there's legal conforming, and that basically means it's legal today. It was legal meaning it was permitted properly to begin with, and then it's conforming with the current code.
Okay.
That's pretty rare. You just have a pretty either an old code book or a new mobile home park development to be legal conforming. That's the best. I've never owned a legal conforming, unless it's one that there's not even a code there because it's in a rural area, and then you're kind of legal conforming. The second classification is legal non-conforming, also known as grandfathering. And this is very common. And this is, the mobile home park was built in 1960. There was no code or minimal city code in 1960, but now there are numerous subsequent code revisions, many of which my old park does not comply with. For example, the new code requires all mobile home parks to have curbs and gutters, stormwater retention, and underground storm shelter.
Right.
Well, my park didn't have that. I'm not going to put all that stuff in. So I'm non-conforming, but I'm legally allowed. The third classification is illegal, meaning I was supposed to never be there, or the guy built it in 1960 in violation of the rules, and it's still been there. I would never buy a legal and illegal park. So for the legal non-conforming, that's where most of the space is, and it gets dicey because some cities have different regulations relating to grandfathering, but the big fight is they'll say typically you cannot exacerbate or enhance a use. So if I've got a 50 unit park that's grandfathered, I can't just build it to 60, But the challenge or the rub comes with, if I've got a 50 unit park, but for the last 30 years, there's only been 25 homes in there. I try to bring in number 26. I try to, or number 25 blows up. I try to bring in number 25 again. And that's where some of the municipalities would fight you and say, no, you've abandoned that use. And there's case law in our support as mobile home park owners to say, no, this is basically a parking lot. As long as I still have a phone number up, as long as I have at least one home in there, I'm operating. Maybe I'm not operating it at all 50, but I'm operating it, so I'm continuing my use and I'm not exacerbating it by going to 51. Therefore, I'm allowed to maintain my rights as a mobile home park. And the code is not allowed to take my constitutional rights or to take the property. And there's a bunch of different paths and derivatives of that, but that's kind of the basic premise of grandfathering. And some cities, especially smaller towns, are ignorant of that a lot of times, or they're just stubborn. And you have to fight them. And there's different ways to fight them, through a variance, through a rezoning, through just enforcing your rights, threatening litigation, which that gets all more complicated. But that's kind of the underlying theory is, mobile home parks have a grandfathered right as long as they don't exacerbate it.
Well, I am sure our listeners and our viewers are going to have a lot of questions. They're going to want to know more about your podcast. So first off, let me ask you briefly, tell me about the podcast.
So the podcast, I launched it about 10 days ago. I've got episode 11 went up today. It's called the Mobile Home Park Lawyer Podcast. You can find it on Apple Podcasts, okay, Spotify. I've got it on my website, themobilehomelawyer.com. But really, this was just an effort to educate people more on the intermediate level topics. There's a lot of podcasts, I think, are very superficial and very beginner. So I want to have a look some more intermediate topics. And really, I get questions. Like, I got a question yesterday about seller. What can go wrong on a seller finance deal? What can go wrong on seller finance and mobile home, Dodd-Frank Act? So I'm like, okay, I'll do a podcast on that. Rather than answer that phone call 30 times. And, I give a lot of free legal advice, quote legal advice from, like, here, just do this. But then it's 15 minutes of my life. Am I going to bill somebody for 15 minutes? I'm like, I'll just give you a quick, but if I do my podcast once, I can be like, hey, go to podcast episode 12. It's on this.
Sure.
So it really just was kind of educate the industry from a legal perspective, which I have a, like I mentioned, unique perspective, having also been an owner operator. So that's the premise of it. And it's a combination of monologue and guest appearances. So the first 10 were monologue. Today I launched one with my dad as my business partner as a guest. Frank Rolf, big owner, is going to be on there tomorrow. Sure. And then I've got a broker mini series, a lender mini series, and so on, to bring on other industry professionals to hopefully educate other people in the industry.
Well, okay, contact information. Now you're going to have people saying, okay, I want to get a hold of Ferd Niemann. I got some questions I want to talk to him about that is not covered on this podcast. How do people reach out to you?
You can send me an email at Ferd, F-E-R-D, at themhplawyer.com. Phone number 833-MHP-LWYR. So MHP lawyer without the vowels, 833-MHP-LWYR. Those would be the best ways to get a hold of me. You have to leave a message on that number, but then I'll get a transcription of it, and I'll call you back and set something up.
Ferd, I've got to thank you. This has been extremely educational. And for our community owners, by all means, if you have any questions, Ferd Niemann is the guy that you need to get a hold of. And with that, Ferd, I want to thank you for being a guest on the program. And for everybody out there, thank you once again for watching the Manufactured Home Show. Goodbye.